May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, our strength and our redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
Got a really fun topic for today. Fear. We all know what it means to be afraid. What do you fear? Now, I don't mean monsters under the bed kinds of fears or bad guys coming to get you kinds of fears, but real life fears, fears that have everything to do with being a human being and going through the various stages of life that we go through. When I was a kid, my biggest fear was the older kids. I was terrified, especially of high school kids. And then in high school, my fear shifted to being afraid of getting bad grades and failing at school, not being successful or getting into the right college. In college, my fears turned toward making a living for myself, how I would get along in the world. And then as a young adult, I was afraid my life would not turn out as I had hoped and planned. And I did have my life all planned out, I'll tell you. I was afraid that I would not have a family of my own or be good enough in my work. And now at this stage in my life, my fears center around relationships, especially relationships with the people in my family. As my parents age, I fear that I am not able to do for them all that I want to do. I'm afraid of what life will be like when they are gone. And I fear for my nieces and nephews as well, and all they are going through. Being a mom and dad, or an aunt or an uncle, or grandparents means going through all those fears again as the children in our lives grow up through the stages of life that we've been through. Can you relate to any of those fears? Do any of them sound familiar? In today's gospel, the disciples are afraid. They have heard Jesus talking yet again about being betrayed and handed over to the authorities and killed. Now, that's something to be afraid of. The last time he was talking about this, Peter took him aside and gave him a hard time about it, no doubt because it was scaring Peter. And that's when Jesus said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan," right? No wonder the rest of the disciples are afraid to ask Jesus what he means. They don't want to get in trouble like Peter got in trouble. But I think the fear is not just about asking Jesus what he means. I think the fear is also about what Jesus is asking of them. Jesus is asking them to let go of what they know, to let go of what they've been taught about how to live in that culture and that day and age, about how to access power and secure their lives for themselves, about how to gain honor. This was an honor and shame culture. They had learned all of that growing up in that culture, and Jesus is asking them to let that go and to face their fears head on, to make the choice to respond out of faith, not fear. Now, the next thing that happens is they start arguing with each other about who is the greatest among them. Now, if anything is a fear response, that is. When we are afraid, we seek to secure ourselves, to find comfort. So after all of Jesus' talk about being betrayed and dying, no wonder they are seeking power and status. They are seeking some way to alleviate their fears, their insecurities, and comfort themselves with the security of knowing they have it under control. I suppose that's something we can all relate to as well. Now Jesus, the master teacher that he is, uses this opportunity to teach them again, what it means to be his followers. He tells them that if they want power and security, if they want comfort and assurance, if they want to be the first among the 12, they need to make themselves the last. Jesus is asking them, in essence, to make themselves vulnerable and insignificant. He is calling them to humility and to that self-emptying love that lets go of the desires of the ego, and being first among the 12 is certainly a desire of the ego, He's calling them to let go of those desires and to shift their perspective to the desire for the love of God. He's asking them to receive a child as if it were Jesus himself. Now, this isn't Jesus being sweet and loving and cute with a little child. Children were understood very differently than we understand kids in our own day. Jesus is taking a child who has no power. Children were ranked among women and slaves. They were property and non-entities. So Jesus takes a vulnerable child who has no power, no rights, and tells them to receive this child as if they were receiving Jesus himself. He is giving them a visual, a concrete image of what that self-emptying love looks like that is so essential to the life of faith. He is showing them what it looks like to give away their own self-earned, family-earned power and to allow the power of God to take hold of them instead. What Jesus is asking of them is really not about putting oneself at risk or being powerless. It's about taking hold of the ultimate true power and authority of the love of God. There is nothing more powerful than that. Jesus is asking them to find their own security and power, not in themselves, but in the love of God. Jesus is asking them to live not out of fear, but out of faith. In Mark's gospel, the opposite of fear is faith. Think about that for a moment. The opposite of fear is faith. So often, Jesus will say something to the effect of, "Do not fear, but have faith." One negates the other. Fear makes faith a hard concept to reach, and faith gives us the fortitude to calm our fears. As much as Jesus is asking all of this of his disciples, Jesus is also asking the same of us. Jesus is asking us to choose God's power, not our own. To choose faith, not fear. To trust that God will give us the fortitude we need to get through whatever life brings. I think about our church, about all of you, and everything you are going through, some of which I know and some of which I don't know. And I think about my own family, what we have been through. And I cannot think of a time for any of us, that faith, that willingness to place our trust in the love of God, did not transform the experience from one of fear to one of grace. Think about that in your own life. When you place your trust in God, when you choose faith and not fear, can you think of a time when your experience wasn't transformed into one of grace? The choice we make to live not out of our fears, but out of faith, is a choice that takes practice. It's not a one-time thing. It's not like you can decide today, okay, I'm going to do this from now on. It doesn't work that way. It's also not something that we can do on our own. It's something that we need each other for. We need the reminders of seeing how each other is going through life. We need examples. We need companions along the way, just people to be with us in this journey of faith, in this journey of our lives. That helps keep us on track. Choosing faith, not fear, is a lifelong practice, and it is what Jesus asks of us. I want to be clear that the thing about choosing faith doesn't mean our fears won't be realized. Some of my fears that I named have been realized. They have come true. But choosing faith gives God the space to transform what we fear most into a life-giving experience, an experience of God's grace beyond our wildest imaginings. Every day, the choice for faith or fear is before us. What will you choose?